A Soyuz for Russia and a Long March for China launch, now on kNews. Hi, Lucas here. Welcome to kNews for week 28, 2017, and a big shout out to all my kNews boosters on Patreon. First up to launch is Soyuz on July 14th, early in the morning UTC from Baikonur in Kazakhstan. On top Soyuz is the Fregata Postage version M, which carries round about 5.6 thousand kilograms of propellant mass to push the payload into its desired orbit. This is an unmanned mission, so the payload consists of a few satellites, from which the main one is called Kanopus-V-IK. It is the second of its kind and was originally meant to launch back in 2012 or 13. However, it was pushed back quite a bit and the tag IK was added to its name, which stands for Infrakrasny, which is infrared in Russian. As a secondary payload, there is Zond, a sun-observing satellite and, according to Russian Space Web, 73 CubeSats for a whole variety of customers. I think it's quite noticeable that more and more CubeSats are being launched recently. Soyuz engines roar alive a few seconds before liftoff to check if they reach and maintain full thrust. Is that the case, the rocket is released and will then shoot up and then to the side towards the North Pole. This trajectory is typical for sun-synchronous orbits, where the rocket is heading since its payloads require a steady view of the sun. Kanopus will take pictures from the ground for maps, but as mentioned, also carries an infrared camera, which is meant to detect fires in the Russian forests. Russia is quite big and it can take weeks before someone notices a fire in certain areas. Now, fires in the forests are quite normal and some plants even need them, but it is always good to know it in advance before somebody gets hurt. Since the satellite will orbit quite closely to Earth in order to get a better ground resolution, it will take 3 days to map a certain spot twice, which means the worst case would be a fire burning unseen for 3 days as well. However, Kanopus-V-IK is of course not the only satellite watching. The secondary satellite Zond needs the same orbit because it will observe the sun and its radiation from visible to ultraviolet light, but also X-rays. One special thing to mention here is it will also record the amount of UV radiation reflected back from Earth, so scientists on ground can compare the values and derive the atmosphere's composition from that. This is possible because different elements in the atmosphere absorb light differently and scientists can compare the results from the satellite to results they achieved in the lab. They basically shoot UV radiation at different gases to know how the reflection looks like and then search their satellite data for similarities. Quite clever actually. I can't tell you much about the CubeSats, but there are plenty and before you think these will all end up as space debris, don't worry. The orbit is low enough so that all of these, even the main payload, will re-enter all by themselves. Kanopus and Zond, however, have thrusters to keep them operational for years, but I think the CubeSats will return in a matter of weeks. Next up to launch is a Chinese Long March 3C, the day after on July 15th from Xichang City in China. At this point, I'm not really sure if the rocket will launch because its bigger brother, Long March 5, had an anomaly recently and didn't reach a stable orbit sadly. So the launch could be delayed, but I'll mention it nonetheless. Up top the medium launcher are two navigation satellites for the Beidou navigation satellite system called Beidou-3 M1 and M2. After the experimental Beidou-1, the regional Beidou-2, China is currently putting a global navigation system together in orbit. There are already a few operational satellites in space, but the complete constellation will consist of 35 and shall be finished by 2020. Some of these will be positioned at a geosynchronous altitude, but the vast majority will revolve around Earth at a medium orbit, like most navigation satellites do. Since this is a global system, everyone should be able to benefit from that, but that of course depends on whether a gadget maker adds a certain new component to their products or not. The signal from space is freely available and you can already reverse track the satellite's position if you set up multiple antennas on ground, tuned for these specific frequencies. Now in the end I want to mention that July is a little low on launches, so the next episode will be a kNews special. Right now I am thinking to maybe do one on Moon or Mars first, which is a debate I don't really understand and I always wanted to read up on it. However, if you have a better idea, feel free to let me know. I have a to-do list which always likes to grow. Okay, that shall conclude episode 92 and I hope to see you next one if you like. Auf Wiedersehen and thank you for watching.